Today I'm going to discuss an explicit example of scattering, and we will basically do the computation from the beginning to the end of the following process. So we consider a scattering of an electron and a positron, which go to a completely different final state, a muon and an antimuon. So this process is a relevant process that is started long ago to see what happens, how you produce new particles at colliders by annihilating a particle with its antiparticle, in this case electron positron. And this has been a very important channel to discover new physics for many years, where people basically collide electron and positron with accelerators. Scanning different energies and seeing what happens. As we saw from the big theorems, everything that can happen will happen at a certain point if it's allowed by symmetries. In particular, this final channel, except that it contains a new particle, has a total quantum numbers which are the same as this. It's electrically neutral, can have the same energy, the same momentum as this. So there is no symmetry that forbids this event to happen. So at a certain point it will happen. So if you scatter the plus and minus, you'll be able to create any state that has the same quantum numbers, in particular mu minus mu plus or qq bar for quarks, anything. So anything that can have and the same quantum number will be created at a certain point. The rate with which you create depends on the way the final particle interacts with the initial particle. Of course, if the coupling is very small, this will be very low probability to happen. You have to work harder to see it.
All the conserved quantities come from the basic symmetries from Lagrangian, both continuous and discrete, right?
Yes.
So if we have some particle that breaks some of these symmetries, like neutrinos, then we should have a Lagrangian that does not obey, for example, parity in that case.
Yes.
Is it right?
Yes. Okay. Yes. So if you're looking for example, a final state which has a different parity from the initial state, this will only happen through interaction which violate parity. So not QED interaction, but other interactions, for example, electroweak interactions. And of course, then the size and the number of events that you'll get in that channel will be proportional to the size of the interaction.
So that interaction would have another coupling constant,
yes,
probably, because it breaks.
Because it will have a different operators, interaction operators, it will have a different coefficient in front. The coefficient will be the coupling. They will control how probable that event it is.
So it means also in diagrams another type of vertex.
Exactly. A vertex that do not preserve parity, for example. Okay, so let me now go through a little bit of kinematics to describe what happens. So let me define some variables. So let's consider the process in the center of mass frame. So let's say that this is the electron and this is the positron incoming, colliding somewhere. And so let me call P1 the momentum of the electron and P2 the momentum of the positron. They collide somewhere, and we are interested in the case where a couple of muon and antimuon will come out. So, and I'm going to call Q1 the momentum of the muon and Q2 the momentum of the antimuon. Just assign some name. And let me call theta the angle between the incoming electron and the outgoing muon. Okay. So let me write here some kinematics. So we are in the center of mass frame. So let me call, so the P1 mu will be a 4 vector with energy and momentum P1, which satisfies that P1 square is equal to M electron square, okay? So E and P, E is related to P1. P2 mu will be E minus P1. Because in the center of mass frame, P2 is equal to minus P1. And the energy is the same, right? Because the modulus of P1 and P2 are the same. For the outgoing muon, the energy with which it goes out, in the center of mass frame, the energy of the two muons are the same. And since energy is conserved, it must be the same as the incoming energy. We call Q1 the 3 vectors of the momentum of the muon. For the other muon, the anti-muon, Q2 mu will then be E minus Q1. Because also, okay, the total momentum is conserved. And I will call S P1 plus P2 squared, which is an invariant, which is also equal to Q1 plus Q2 squared, which is equal to 4E squared. It's the total energy in the center of mass squared. Okay, there are other. Of course, in principle, I could write all the products of this explicitly. We're going to use them later, but maybe I will write them later when we use it. Okay? So let's go directly now to the calculation. So we want to compute this process, particularly the cross-section, the total cross-section for this process to happen. So we need to compute the amplitude using the Feynman diagrams. Let's derive the Feynman diagrams. So in the in state, we have an electron and a positron. So our in state would be like an electron, so an incoming arrow like this, and a positron, which is an incoming particle with the opposite arrow, because it's an antiparticle. Okay. This is our in state. Our out state would be a muon and an anti-muon. These are our external states. Now, if you remember, all we have to do is to insert interaction vertices and connect them in all possible ways. First of all, which interaction vertices we should put? You remember, the interaction in QED is just psi bar slash psi. Each vertex has one photon and a particular fermion antifermion. Here we need both interaction for the electron and interaction with the muon, otherwise this process will not happen. But the vertex for the electron and the muon are the same. So we'll have one vertex with electrons and one vertex with muons. We have at least one vertex with electron and one vertex with muon. Otherwise, you cannot destroy and create the initial standard particles. So this is the minimum amount of vertices that you need to make this process happen. And now we have to connect the lines in all possible ways. Well, in this case, there is not much freedom we are left because we have to use the electrons and the positron, which are the only one to destroy the initial particles, the muon and anti-muon to create the final particle, and then we are left with the only contraction possible between the photon between the two, which is this. And this basically is the only Feynman diagram contributing to this process at this order. Of course, could start adding more vertices. In that case, we'll have extra Feynman diagrams, but those other Feynman diagrams will be further suppressed by the coupling, the electric coupling, so will be subleading corrections. Is it clear? So this is probably the simplest process to do two scattering you can draw in QED. I'm going to rewrite the diagram in a more beautiful way. The momentum along this line must be by energy momentum conservation must be the sum of P1 plus P2, which is also equal to Q1 plus P2 because of momentum conservation. So I basically assigned all the momentum to all the lines. Remember, for each vertex, we also have some. Mu Lorentz index for the vertex, for the gamma mu in the vertex. And then you have the polarization of the initial and the final state, which at the moment I don't write explicitly, then we will see. So let me write now the amplitude following the rules that we derived some lectures ago. For the scattering amplitude, in particular IN. So what we have to do, we remember for the fermionic line, we have to follow them against their arrows. So we have first this one. So if we follow against the arrow, we have to start from here. This is an external antiparticle. So it gives me a factor which is V bar with the momentum P2. Here there will be also the polarization, for example, the electricity of the electron H2. But let me not write it explicitly. Okay. So this is this spin on here. Then we arrive to the vertex. The vertex gives me a IE gamma mu contribution. And then we have the incoming electron. This is a particle, so give me a U spinor coming to P1. And this line is finished. Indeed, all the spinor indices are contrasted into scalar. Then I have another fermionic line. Let me write this. So I start again from following the line against the arrow. In this case, I have a particle, the mu minus. So I have a U bar Q1 factor. I get the vertex here, which is a IE gamma nu.
Shouldn't we distinguish the psi for electron and mu?
Yes, but the one with P are the electron and the one with Q are the muon, so I remember this way.
So in addition to the momentum, we have the type of the field or the...
Yes, so this spinor doesn't talk with the spinor. this is spinner for the mu, and this is spinner for the M. And here we have the final factor, which is an antiparticle outgoing, the mu plus, so it's a V Q2. Then we're just left with the internal propagator for the photon. So the internal propagator, remember, you give me a minus g mu nu, where mu and nu are the indices contracted with the photonic line, so mu and nu. So give me minus I g mu nu over the p square of the momentum of the photon, which in this case is p1 plus p2 square. Okay, so this again, there is a simplification. I have three i's and a minus, you need one I, e squared. P1 plus P2 squared is nothing that s. So it's this over s. And then I can use this g mu nu to contract these indices. So this is just v p2 bar gamma mu u p1 times u bar q1 gamma mu v q2. So this is our amplitude. Okay. Now for the actual cross section, what we care is not just the amplitude, but the modulus square of the amplitude. So let's consider now the modulus square of M. So the I will disappear, then e to the 4 over s square. And I have to do the modulus square of these factors. So let me do first the modulus square of the first factor here. So I have v bar p2 gamma mu up1. Modulus square. So modulus square, then I can do the complex conjugate of this. So I get a u bar p1 gamma nu v p2. So if you do the complex conjugate here, you get a u dagger gamma mu dagger gamma naught V, then gamma naught with gamma mu dagger becomes gamma mu gamma naught, so you get u bar gamma mu V. I change mu and nu indices here because this mu will be contracted with this mu. When in modulus square you get a nu contracted with another nu, which is a complex conjugate of this. So I call it different. And you can do the same for the second factor, which then will give you a u bar q1 gamma mu v q2 times v bar q2 gamma nu u q1. So this is the modulus square. So it's basically the probability that E plus E minus goes to mu plus mu minus, where the electron and the muon are represented by the spinors, which encode basically the information about the helicity or the spin of this incoming outgoing particle. Now, let's say now that we perform this experiment, we collide the plus E minus going to the plus mu minus. Our detector, which will detect the muon, is not sensitive to the polarization of the muon. So we, at the end of the day, we will count events to compare with the cross-section. And we count events independently on the orientation of the spins or of each of the muon and anti-muon. So which means that this corresponds to compute the total probability of any muon with the spin oriented in any direction, which means that we want to sum over all possible spins of the final particle here. Okay. For instead the incoming spins of the electron and positron, let's say that our beams of electron and positrons are not polarized. So we didn't prepare them in any way. So the spins are equally randomly distributed up and down. And this means that we want to average over all possible incoming spins of the electron and the positron. Just sum over all possibilities and then you average over them. So it gives you the average spin. This is because you have no information. If your beams are polarized or your detector is sensitive to the final spin of the muon, then you might want to keep that information with the spinners. Let's do now the computation in the case you're not interested in this kind of information and don't polarize the initial spin. Okay? So this means that now we are summing over all spins of both of the incoming and the outgoing particles. We want to average over the incoming ones. Each electron at two polarization. So it means that averaging means to sum over this, sum over that, and divide it by 1/2 and 1/2 here. So you have a factor of 1/4 from the average of the incoming electron and positron. Now, this sum of spins simplifies. Let me do like this. This factor is here.
Does the summing is over the possible polarization of muon? Or
possible?
The average? Is the possible polarizations of muon?
It's the sum over all polarization of muons and anti-muons,
okay.
And average over the electron and anti-electron. Is it clear?
But if we what average specific average of spin for the electron should we expect to get from muon the same average quantity?
No, there's a difference between the incoming and outgoing particle. Incoming, imagine you don't know any. You don't have any information on the incoming particle. You want to average because you want to know the probability that a random electron will produce a particular muon. So think about what when we discussed last time about the cross section. You have like a bunch of electrons, like a bunch of positrons, and you collide them. Each electron has either spin up or spin down, and you don't know. So it's a randomly distributed. The final number of events will be the sum over all the spins averaged. Mm-hmm. Okay? Well, in particular, the cross section is the probability for a couple of them to to make the interactions. So it can be either spin up or spin down. So at the end, when you sum over all particles spin up and spin down, you want to consider the average. For the final particle, instead, you want to count over all possible events. So either they spin up or they spin down. So you sum the probability that you get a spin up plus the probability you get a spin down, and you get the probability that you get either spin up or spin down. So you don't average, you just. So the sum over spins, now it's really a sum over either the ellipses or the spin R index that we put it here. And actually simplifies this computation because it gets rid, with this sum, we get rid of the actual spin representation. And we can write everything in a Lorentz, nice Lorentz invariant way. So we can use indeed the fact that the sum over spin of, let's say, a u r p u bar r p spinor, it's also equal to p slash minus m from the completeness relation, and the sum over r of v p r v p r bar is equal to p slash sorry, this is plus and this is minus. So if you apply this to a U, it gives you zero by the rotational motion, this will give you 2m for the normalization of spins. So here we have all these sums here. There will be sums over the R indices here, the S indices here, whatever you call it there. So it means that the sum over spin here will give you a P1 slash plus the mass of this particle, which is an electron. So from here we get a factor P1 slash plus M electron. So notice this is a matrix in spinorial space, so which means the two indices of this matrix here saturates with the gamma here and the gamma there, because you're using the spinor here and the spinor there.
So this expression is actually not a simple matrix multiplication. We saturate the indices so that at the end we get a number, not a matrix.
So these are the product of four numbers now. Because each of these is a number. But when you sum over polarization here, since there are indices here, and we sum over polarization, you see you connect the index here from to the index there. So now, if you sum this polarization here, this this spin index here, all this become a number. But it will be V bar gamma mu, P slash plus N, gamma mu, V. Because if you put correctly the indices here, I, j, k, l, this ik become ik here, and now you have the contraction i, j, k, l here. Similarly, you can contract this V with this V, which are the same, the spin for the same particle. So if you sum over this spin index here, you have sum of V, V bar. V, V bar give me P slash minus N. So you see that here, this disappears. This V, V bar becomes a P2 slash minus M electron, and now the indices here was saturating between this gamma and this gamma here. So the two indices here you have to saturate, one with this gamma and the other with the left of this gamma here, and this produces a trace because all the indices are cyclically saturated with themselves. Okay, so let me write here, you get 1/4 m sum over spins of m on root square is equal e to the 4 over 4 s square. So from here we get trace of let's do from here for example p1/+me, then you have a gamma nu p2/-me gamma mu. And similarly, here, from here you get a q2/-mass. Now this is a muon, so you get the mass of the muon here. And from here and here, you get the factor q1/+m of the muon. So all together, you get trace. Let's say q1/+ mass of the muon gamma mu q2/- mass of the muon gamma nu. So everything now is written. So the information on the spinning you see is lost. Because something only depends on the momenta, the masses, and traces of gamma masses. At the end, it's a, you find a scalar. A Lorentz scalar.
For spinor indices, there is no difference between right mid and upper mid, or is there any difference?
RS, you mean indices? No. Well, the up and down, when you write the indices up and down, it makes sense, the position, only if you define a metric for that space, which is not the identity. Then you can use the method to lower and raise the indices in a non-trivial way. For other, if you don't have such a notion. All right, so we have to compute now these traces. Actually, I didn't ask you, did you already saw the identity of gamma matrices, traces of gamma matrices, properties, like what is a trace of gamma mu, gamma nu, what is a trace of four gamma matrices. No. Yes, no. In RQM, we... Okay. Okay, so we have to compute these traces. So you see, each of these, when you expand the argument of each these traces, these are just traces of some product of gamma matrices. So traces of an odd number of gamma matrices, they always give zero. So So you only get contribution from traces of even number of Gaussian matrices. I don't want to spend the lecture deriving the identities between traces of Gaussian matrices, but I just give you the relevant one for this computation. You can find in various books of quantum field theory, usually in the appendices, the list of all the properties of traces of Gaussian matrices and product of Gaussian matrices, which are easy to derive, but you have a question?
No. So we need to drive them, or we can just use them. I mean,
you can use them, but you see that they I show you some of them, so I show you how to derive them in general. Imagine you have the trace of gamma mu, gamma nu. Well, first of all, you can write gamma mu, gamma nu always as a sum of anti-commutator plus commutator. The trace of a commutator is always zero, so you get that this is also equal to 1 half the trace of the anti-commutator. The anti-commutator is 2 g mu, so the 1 half and 2 simplified, you get g mu nu times the trace of the identity, which is 4. So this is 4 g mu. Mm-hmm. Imagine you have a trace of 4 gamma matrices. Here is a little bit more involved. One general rule you can follow is the following. If you apply like Spinoria transformation to this, if you start adding SS minus 1, SS minus 1, blah, 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 and using the fact that S minus 1, gamma mu, S is lambda mu, nu, gamma nu, it's like a Lorentz transformation, you'll find that basically this must also be must be invariant under Lorentz transformation. So this must be a quantity with 4 Lorentz indices, which is invariant. Implicitly, with 4 Lorentz indices, you can create 2 structures of invariant tensor, one with using the metric, g mu nu, g mu rho. So for example, you can add a g mu nu g rho sigma. This is an invariant tensor with the mu nu rho sigma. Have b g mu rho g mu sigma c g mu sigma g mu rho, all possible combination basically of a couple of things. In principle, you can also add one which is proportion to epsilon mu nu rho sigma, because all this is also an invariant tensor with 4 indices. But you can see that this is zero because this is parity odd, basically this is parity even. You get this only if you have also gamma 5 here. And to fix this coefficient here, you can just saturate, for example, these two indices and this with the g mu nu g rho sigma. Here you can easily compute at this point, because if you saturate g mu nu, g rho sigma, this, you can compute a trace, you get a number. Then you saturate with the same g, and here if you saturate g mu nu, g rho sigma, here you get 4 times 4, 16. Here you get instead 4, because you have sigmoidal, 4 sigmoidal. So you get basically a relation between A, B, C, and some number. Then you saturate with mu rho, nu sigma, you get another condition, one other combination of ABC, so on in all possible combinations. You have basically a system of 3 equations with 3 unknown, and you fix A, B, and C. So this is a general strategy to derive all these identities. Okay? So in this case, the answer is 4 here for a mu rho, no, minus 4 here, and 4 here. You can check that this satisfies it. So basically you get a factor of 4 for nearby indices and minus 4 when you do an anti-commute 2. All right. So now here you see that you get a term which is minus me squared trace of 2 gammas, and then trace of 4 gammas when you take p1 and p2 slash gamma and gamma mu here. So let's write, let me erase this because otherwise it will take space. So let's compute the first trace. You saw all the traces we draw before had a factor of 4 in front. So this factor of 4 I can factor out. So I have 2 factors of 4 for each trace, so I get a factor of 4 in the numerator. And then I have, let's compute first this trace of 4 gamma matrices. We pick up this p1, gamma nu, p2, gamma mu. So this gives me a factor of, so there was a g mu nu between the first and the second, the third and the fourth, which gives me a p1 nu, p2 mu. Because the gamma matrix of this, inside this slash, was giving me a gamma g, a metric factor between this index and this index, which I use to write p1 with this index. And same for this. Then I have the same with p1 with this, p2 with that. Minus p1, p2, gamma mu, gamma nu with the g mu nu. So minus g mu nu, p1 dot p2. And then I have the factor coming from the m. There is a minus m squared g mu nu. G mu nu is already here, so I get plus m squared. Now you see this factor here is basically the same as this, except that instead of p you have q's, instead of me you have a mu, and mu and mu are exchanged, but everything is symmetric and the mu and mu exchanged, so it doesn't matter. So just rewrite the same factor with p instead of q instead of p and mu instead of me. So I get a q. q1 mu, q2 mu, plus q1 mu, q2 mu, minus g mu mu, q1 dot q2, plus n mu square.
The order of indices inside the
doesn't
trace
matter.
Does not
it's
matter.
Symmetric between mu and u, no?
And also in the final expression does not matter, so we can...
It's symmetric, no?
I see.
Q1, Q2 plus Q2, Q1, so... These are not matrices, no? Okay. And now I'm going to do the product. So let's start. This times this. So this times this give you P1, Q1, P2, Q2. Probably not. Let me write in order mu mu. Mu mu. So it's the same order as here. This will give you P1, Q1, P2, Q2, plus P1, Q1, P2, Q2. So let's write P1, Q1, times P2, Q2, two times, plus this times this and this times this, that give you P1, Q2, the other combination. Q1, P2. So this 2 times the 2 give you 4 times, 2 plus 2, 1 with P1, Q1, P2, Q2, and the other which is across, P1, Q2, Q1, P2. Then you have this times this. So here, Gmu and Gmu are contracted between themselves and give a factor of 4. Minus and minus give you a plus, so there will be plus 4. And then you just write the product of P1, P2 plus Me squared times Q1, Q2 plus M mu squared. Oh, I did finish. And then we have this with this and this with that, with minuses. So I have minus, let's go first, this with this. So again, G mu nu, P1, P2 plus P2, P1, give you 2, P1, P2. Times that factor, which is Q1, Q2 plus M mu squared. And analogous factor, minus 2, Q1, Q2 times P1, P2 plus M e squared. Now to simplify a little bit. So let me pull out factor of 2. Big simplification. Now I want to rewrite basically all these products of momenta in a simpler way. I have to use some of the identities here. So let me write them down. So first of all, let me write this. So let's compute first P1, P2. So P1, P2, you see, is nothing else than, I can derive it from here, I can write P1 plus P2 square minus 2 ME square. It gave me 2 P1, P2, then I divide by 2. But this is what I was calling S. So this is just S over 2 minus m squared. And I can do exactly the same for Q1, Q2. So this is also equal to S over 2 minus n mu squared. So you see the combination where you have Q1, P2 plus m squared, for example here, this is just S over 2. And this is just S over 2. So here, I have to use P1, Q1, you see, it's nothing except E squared minus P1, Q1, 3 vector. So this is E squared minus P1, Q1, cos theta. P1 dot Q1 3 vector is just the modulus, the product of the modulus and the cosine of the angle between them. Then you should see that P2 Q2 is the same because it's a square minus a minus is a plus is again P1 dot Q1. So P2 Q2 is also equal to P1 Q1. P1, Q2, instead, P1, Q2, is the same with an extra minus. And it's the same as P2, Q1. So now we have all the products written in terms of either the energy and the moment, okay? Or the masses. So here we have P1, Q1 and P2, Q2. Maybe first let me simplify this. I just simplified this, right? P1, P2 plus m squared also was equal to S over 2. And it's also equal to S over 2. Let me write 8 e to the 4 over s squared. Now, hope I don't make too many mistakes. P1, Q1, and P2, Q2. No, P1, Q1. And P2, Q2 were equal to each other. So this is also equal to P1, Q1 squared, and P1, Q2 is equal to Q1, P2, so this is also P1, Q2 squared. Then this is S squared over 2, so this is 1/2, 1/2, and a 2. And this is minus S over 2. And here you have P1, Q1, P1, P2 plus Q1, Q2 to multiply. and P1, P2 plus Q1, Q2 is S minus M minus M. You see the S squared term simplifies. And now I write everything in terms explicitly in terms of this, maybe. See what I want to write. Yes, a little bit more. So let's see, let me write step by step. By the time P1 Q1 was equal to 8 e to the 4 over S square. E square minus P1 Q1 cos theta all square plus E square plus P1 Q1 cos theta square. This minus minus give me plus S over 2 times ME plus MU. So I have plus ME square MU square. Oh, plus times S over 2. Now let's write everything in terms of E. So S was 4 E squared, right? So this is S squared is 16 e to the 4. So with the 8, just give me 2 e to the 4. These two terms give me a e to the 4. The cross term simplifies, and then you get twice this square. So plus twice P1 square, Q1 square, cos square. So let me write cos square. P1 square, Q1 square. But P1 square, Q1 square, I can use the relation with E square. So P1 square is nothing that E squared minus the mass of the electron squared, and Q1 squared is equal E squared minus the mass of the muon squared. So I write everything just in terms of the energy. And here S is again 4 E squared, so I get 2 plus 2 square m electron square plus m mu square. Mm-hmm. almost there. I hope it's correct. So let's bring a 2e to the 4 inside. So we get that our 1 quarter sum of the n squared is this e to the 4 in front, multiply 1 from the first term in a 2 simplified way. Then there is, let's write this term first, which is plus m e squared plus n mu squared over e squared. And then here, the 2 goes away, I have e to the 4, I bring it in. So it's plus 1 minus m e squared over e squared, 1 minus m mu squared over e squared, cos squared theta. Believe it or not, it's correct. Okay, so this is the amplitude square, average and then summed over the spins. So you see there is a non-trivial dependence on the center of mass energy, on the energy of the initial state E, and non-trivial dependence on the theta angle. From here you already see this term here, it's positive definite, because this is always less than 1. Always less than 1, so this is positive definite. So the biggest contribution you'll have when cosine square theta is equal to 1, which means cosine theta equal to either plus or minus 1, which are the direction along the axis. So most particles, most muons, will be produced either in this direction or in this direction. Actually, it will be a pair along the axis. Instead, less muons will be produced off-axis. But still, non-zero. Actually, just a factor of this plus this.
On the phi plane, there is no dependence.
There is no dependence on the phi plane, because there is the problem of a symmetry, a rotation symmetry along the axis.
So it's uniformly?
It's a completely uniformly distributed along the phi axis. If you want to break that degeneracy along the phi axis, you have to, you can do it if you, for example, polarize the spin. So you introduce a new symmetry, and you quantity breaks the rotation symmetry around the axis. The dynamics of the process already breaks the rotation around theta, because you have the two beams here. So you see, the experiment is not invariant if you rotate, but it's invariant if you rotate around the beam. Before commenting on the final result, let me finish. This was just the modulus square of the amplitude. Now I have to plug it in to the expression for the cross-section we computed last time. In particular, remember there was, we defined the differential cross-section, the sigma and the omega, in the center of mass frame. In this case, if you remember the formula, there was a factor of 1 over 4 pi square q1 over p1 from the phase space factor and the initial state factor, and there was 1 over 4s and the modulus square of the amplitude. So we have to insert this factor here, e to the 4. So let me call this ratio xe and this ratio x mu, the ratio between the mass and the energy of the particle square. So I write this in a more compact way. This is also equal to, you can rewrite, you see, the gap in terms of the fine structure constant, e squared over 4 pi, we have two powers, e to the 4 over 4 pi squared. So this is proportion to alpha squared. There is a 4s factor in front. Also q1 and p1 you can write in terms of using expansion ratio mass of the electron in the problem. So Q1 is square root of E square minus M mu square. This is square root, so you can write this as 1 minus X mu over 1 minus X E to the 1 half. Times 1 plus X E. So first of all, this process only happens if you are able to satisfy the conservation of energy momentum. So the initial energy for the electron must be large enough to be able to produce the muons. In particular, 1 minus x mu must be larger than 0, otherwise you'll still get the cross section which is imaginary. And in particular, you see that this cross section goes to 0 when x mu goes to 1. X mu equal to 1 means basically that you produce the muon at rest, the momentum of the final particle at rest. So if you plot basically the cross section as a function of the energy, we find that 0 before the mass of the muon, and then you start producing a cross section which is different from 0 only after you reach the energy to produce the muon. So you get, it increases from 0 with the square root with the energy. And at the very large energies, this x goes to 0, because they go like the mass of the energy. So when the energies are much larger than the particle, in particular, you see Xe is always negligible, because the energy must be at least m mu. So this Xe is at most m electron over m mu 1, which is 10 to the minus a lot. 10 to the minus 2 squared, 10 to the minus 4. So this gives you only 0.01% corrections. And if you go to energy much larger than the mass of the muon, also x mu goes to 0. So in this limit of very large energy, this expression further simplifies, because this goes to 1, this factor. And so at large energy, the expression of d sigma in d omega goes into alpha squared over 4s. This is 1. This is 1 plus cos squared theta.
Okay. Can you repeat it again? Yes, when just after the mass of the medium, how the dependence should be?
It's ready. So this is the function, the specific function of with energy and the masses. So it goes to zero when x mu goes to one, so when the energy is equal to the mass of the muon. As the energy increases, this factor increases,
but
like
also,
the square root.
But also we
yeah, for very small difference, this dominates, and then at very large energies, this you get to this, which goes to zero, like 1 over t squared. So this is a common factor, 1 over s, which always appears. So in principle, you can just plot the product of s times the cross section. So in that case, the 1 over s you don't see. It just so if you just plot s times sigma, then you'll find that this goes to a constant. And actually, this constant measures the numbers of degrees of freedom you produce with this channel. Imagine you could produce other particles. Then, beside the muons, you get another contribution, which is a large energy, which will be exactly the same. If the charge is the same, if the charge is different, there will be also a factor proportional to the charge of the other particle. So basically, this cross-section is an extra contribution every time you produce a particle. So by just studying how this cross-section increases, you can see what are the particles in the theory which are electrically charged and can be produced by plus and minus.
How is cross-section measured in experiments, or what does it mean?
Ah, it's what I tried to explain last time. The number of events actually experiment is proportional to the cross section. So you just count the number of events in your detector, and you modulo that you know how many particles you put in at the beginning, and then you extract what is the cross section, and you compare with the experiment.
But we can have total cross section or a differential cross section.
So this differential cross section gives you the number of events that come out, the differential number of events that come out with this angle. So now imagine your detector is placed not everywhere, but is placed, for example, here and here and here and here, like this. So you're only sensitive between this angle and this angle. Then you have to integrate this differential cross-section along this angle, and you get the number of events that your detector can see.
So in either cases, we can always say that using S times cross-section quantity, we distinguish different channels of reactions.
Yes. So imagine your detector do not recognize which particle you produce, because it's sensitive to any particle that produce a shower, electromagnetic shower inside the detector. You just count how many showers you produce. And then you compare with this formula, and then by just comparing the cross-section for the production of each formula, actually you compare more. You can compare that the actual dependence on this angle is exactly the one predicted by this. You can compare that the shape with the energy is exactly like this, and indeed, if you put the experimental numbers, you will see that there is perfect agreement with this curve and what you can measure in the experiment. Perfect agreement, of course, it depends on which precision you go. If you go very high precision, there is a little disagreement. And the little disagreement is fixed by higher order perturbation theory. So if you include other diagrams, then you can start drawing, adding more vertices, produce correction to this formula, which is proportional to higher power of alpha, And those are exactly the one you need to fit the actual spring. So you can test not only the leading prediction, but also the sub-leading corrections, and check that indeed the theory well reproduces the experiment.
So for example, in quantum physics, we have see that how color is found. So
yeah, it's exactly like this.
But three times more than
Because this is the contribution from the muon. Imagine you have other particles, for example, the quarks. You have these other diagrams also contributing. When you sum over final particle, you have to sum over the number of quarks. And actually, the quark, the vertex of the quark, you also have a different factor because the charge of the quark can be different. So the total cross-section will be the cross-section to create mu plus mu minus plus the cross-section to create QQ bar. Inside the cross-section is getting QQ bar, it goes like the charge. So this cross-section QQ bar, actually without even computing, you know that if you redo the same computation, you get exactly the same expression with the same dependence on the momenta, except that on the vertex, there is also a factor of the charge of the quark. In the amplitude, it means in the cross-section is square. And then when you sum over final state, there's a number of final state, number of quarks, with that charge square. Now, what you can do is just to compare, to compute the ratio, and to compare how many quarks jet of colored object you produce for each muon that you produce. So you just compute the ratio between QQ bar and mu. So you just count the total number of QQ bar you produce, you divide by the total number of muons you produce. So this ratio only knows about this. It doesn't know anything about the theta dependence, the energy dependence, because as I say, the factor out in the ratio. The ratio only knows this. In the limit, of course, that you are much higher than the mass, and this xe, x mu, xq are negligible. And from here, you just can count the color number, the charge of the name. So this formula is accurate up to alpha correction. The first correction to this formula comes from diagrams of this kind, where you add at least a couple of vertices. Since you add the two vertices, you add the new contribution will be suppressed by e squared, so it will be suppressed by alpha. Alpha is a small number, it's 10 to the minus 2. Actually, as I argued before, it's not just alpha, it's alpha over 4 pi, so it's like 10 to the minus 3. So this formula reproduces experiment to the precision of per mil accuracy. Of course, when you go to higher order, you start considering this diagram, there are many more diagrams that you can draw. You can draw this, you can draw this, you can draw this, and so on. One like this. So the computation of the next two leading order correction, the sub-leading correction, will be much longer than the computation we did in the blackboard.
Do people still do these calculations by hand or computers?
Up to one loop you can do by hand. Just spend a couple of days, maybe. above that, it's not very efficient, because also the length of the calculation becomes maybe, if that takes a couple of days, one loop, two loops may take a couple of months. And the probability to make mistakes also grows factorially. So, and if you make a mistake, in a 2 months calculation by hand, to redo the error. So
people use a computer program.
I didn't say, you can integrate over theta and get the total cost error. So imagine your detector can actually see all the angles. So all you have to do is to integrate over d phi, d theta, this. So if you do this, you get basically, from here you get 2 plus 8 there, you get 16 there, this is d phi, the sigma total. Alpha squared. So after 1 hour and a half computation, you get a cross section.
To it from the reverse, you know the dimension of the sigma, and you know there's a structure cancel.
Yes.
It should depend on that.
Yeah, you can derive everything except the 4/3 from
this is one.
1 point, the 30% accuracy. You can do. Of course, if you want the theta dependence, it's a little bit more. Actually, theta dependence really depends on which particle you exchange. If you do the same computation but with a scalar field, you'll get so this theta dependence, if you want, also measure the spin of the mediator of the interaction. Okay. Can take a little bit more.
So mentally, when we produce quark and quark, we will get a jet of hadrons. So the diagram will, when we
will be more complicated, there is hadronization.
Okay. So but we consider only like the first step after the the vertex, and we do the calculation up to this point.
Yes.
With the correction of the vertex with the charge, and that's it.
Yeah. But it's enough, at least at very high energies, because after you produce Q, Q bar, once you compute the probability to get Q, Q bar, then Q, Q bar, the only thing they can do is to hadronize with the probability order 1. You cannot do anything else.
Mm-hmm.
So you will not change the cross-section. At least a very high energy where QCD is, which is a strong interaction, are perturbative.
Mm-hmm.
We have a correction to this diagram coming from QCD interaction instead of photon gluons, which are the mediator of the QCD interaction. This will affect a little bit the contribution QQ bar. But this can be computed in the same way, perturbation theory, and indeed the perturbative correction computed in this way from QCD interactions exactly match the experiment. So you also test the mediator of strong interactions by computing the correction and comparing the experiment. More questions? Did you, in particular physics course, did you discuss about the optical theorem? Yes. So maybe I'll take five minutes, 10 minutes more to rediscuss the optical theorem in terms of so you go to the final expression that the sigma, the cross-section, the total cross-section is related to the imaginary part of the amplitude. Maybe I don't even need to do it again. Then. Maybe I can skip. So maybe I'll use those 10 minutes to just partly overview particle decay. And which is somehow outside the QD course, but it's useful to have the formula. So let me just briefly discuss what happens if you instead consider the process where the in state is only considered by one particle, and the out state it's more particle. Well, this case is a little bit ill-defined, because if a particle can decay to more particles, then it was not there at equal to minus infinity to start with. So we will see you will pose some problem in the if you just follow straightforwardly the procedure we saw before. But let's ignore for the moment the problem and just let's try to do what we already did for the cross section. So the probability for this transition 1 to n, remember, was the modulus square of the out state, and here was the S matrix, the one particle state square. And here we put some wave function of the initial state, remember? So this object is nothing else than the integral in d3p over 2 pi cube 1 over 2 omega p, d3p bar over 2 pi cube 2 omega p bar. These are the integrals that are inside the wave function complex conjugate. We have a psi p and a psi p bar star, the wave function of the initial state, and 2 pi to the 4 delta 4 p minus q total. P is the four momentum of the initial state. Q total is the total of the momentum of the final state. And this delta was there in the matrix element for the amplitude. And since it's modulus squared, there is also a 2 pi to the 4 delta 4 p bar minus q total. And then, of course, there is the phase space integral, the differential, and the amplitude 1 to q, p to q if you want, q total, and m star q total to p bar to q. So this is exactly the analog of this was the probability, the differential probability, if you want, that one particle in this case goes to a final state of Q, of n particle with momenta just defined inside the Now here, remember, what we did the last time was to use the delta to remove the integrals. But before we had more integrals, a little bit less deltas. Now we have more deltas than integrals. In particular, you have three integrals for p-bar, but four deltas for p-bar. So if you use, for example, the three special delta to remove the integral in B3 p-bar, 2 pi cube, you get here just the delta of the p-bar 0 Malsky total, the time part.
Q total 0.
Q total?
0.
Zero, yes. But you see, p, the special p, thanks to the delta, has been fixed to the special q. But the special q will be equal to the special p. And the special p, since it's an out state, is equal to omega p. So here you get basically delta of 0. So this is also equal to delta of omega p minus q 0 dot, which is delta of 0 because of this other delta. So you get infinity. And this infinity is related to the fact that this probability is ill-defined.
We get it after we integrate the deltas, the second delta.
Yeah, we have two deltas which are the same. So one delta can use to integrate, and then you are left with delta of 0 for the other one.
What did this not happen before?
We had, before we had two integrals, the 3p1, the 3p2, and six deltas. So we have as many integrals as many deltas. Now we have three integral less and two delta less. The two delta of the impact parameter we don't have anymore. Okay, but now the interpretation of this delta is the following. You remember the general definition of a delta is relative to the integral in dt, e to the minus I t, we say tau, omega p minus q total. So since omega p is equal to q total from here you get this factor is 1, so you get an integral between minus infinity and plus infinity to infinity. But instead of integrating over infinity, let's consider the process, the amplitude at finite time. So at finite time, this integral goes up to some time t. So now will be, say, let's say that you also start at finite time, so you get something that is proportional to delta t, which makes more sense. The probability is growing with time that you convert from the initial state to the final state. So to avoid this ambiguity, instead of considering the amplitude to go from one time to the other time, from the initial state to the final state, you can consider the differential probability that this process happens. So what is the probability per unit time for this to happen, which is means this corresponds to take the derivative with respect to time, which basically say to remove this integral. So if you consider the derivative with respect to time of this differential probability, so the probability, the differential probability per unit time, this is also called the rate, delta gamma, is a differential rate, because what's a differential probability? This is just a derivative with respect to time. So when you derive with respect to time, this is a factor of 1. This will give you a factor of 1. And now you're just left with this factor here. As before, p bar, thanks to the deltas, is set equal to p. And then you can assume that your wave function is p around some p. You can bring it out from the data indicator p of psi modulus square is minus 1. So you'll be left with an expression which is 1 over 2 omega p from here. M of p to q total modulus square d phi n and the delta function, p pi to the 4, delta 4 of p minus q total. So this is the formula for the differential rate that a particle with energy omega p decays into a particular final state. Integrate over the possible final states, integrate over the differential, you get the total decay rate. So if this is the probability that this process happens, it means that if you have n particle, then the total number of particles decays with time with the rate dn in dt, which is equal to minus gamma n. Because gamma is the probability for 1 to decay per unit time. So the number of particles decay per unit time is proportional to gamma, is proportional to the number of particles. Which after integration give you the number of particles goes like an exponential controlled by this decay rate gamma. The inverse is also can also associate to the lifetime of the particle tau. So tau is defined as 1 over gamma. Notice that this quantity is not Lorentz invariant. As usual, the amplitude is Lorentz invariant. These are Lorentz invariant factors, but here you have an explicit dependence on omega p. This is because we just took the derivative with respect to time in some frame. So sometimes you find the formula in the rest frame of the particle, which is the same formula with the omega p equal to the mass of the particle. This is also the one, this is differential, the lifetime will be the inverse of this. And then you can see that if you boost, you go to a laboratory frame in which the particle is moving, the lifetime is basically increased by a gamma factor, which is consistent with the fact that the moving frame time is lower.
So my experiments, when they detect a particle with certain width on the plot, that width is dependent on the velocity of the particle, or is always the same?
Pero, let's get to the width in a second, because of course that is not a real part, but yes. Okay, so this is the usual derivation of the lifetime. Of course, you might worry it's a little bit ill-defined, because after all, you went through a definition here of an asymptotic state that doesn't exist. And indeed, it is a little bit, because you are not supposed to treat this as an asymptotic state that existed forever. But so it's correct. But maybe a more satisfactory way to see the same thing is to actually embed the particle in a full process. So this particle that we treated as an initial state was not there forever. It must have been created by some process. This is our particle at some time. And then it will decay in particle. The particle that is unstable cannot last forever. So it means that its lifetime is counted from the time it is produced. So an unstable particle is always some internal line or some bigger diagram. So it's always a virtual particle. And indeed, we can recover the understanding of these unstable particles as resonances by using the optical theorem. If you remember, the optical theorem tells you that twice the imaginary part of a forward amplitude, the amplitude where the initial state and the final state are the same, it's related to the sum over all possible final particle, the modulus square of, let's say, okay, modulus square of the amplitude times 2 pi to the 4 delta 4. So we can use the optical theorem for amplitude of one particle to one particle. So this is a one-to-one process, which is equal to 1 to the modulus square of the amplitude of 1 to n particle, in this way. Now, if you see this expression, it's nothing else than this factor here. When you sum over all possible final state. So this is also equal to 2 omega gamma. So you can relate the decay rate for an unstable particle to the imaginary part of the one-to-one amplitude of that particle. So in fact, this is indeed what happens if you consider one-to-one process explicitly. So let's take the one-to-one amplitude diagrams. In particular, let's look at the single propagator and compute corrections to the single propagator, which is basically related to the amplitude from one particle to one particle. So at leading order in perturbation theory, you have this contribution in momentum space, I over p squared minus m squared. Now I'm discussing just a scalar particle, not to worry about spins and stuff, but it's similar things will happen in general. If you add higher order, you can write in general diagram for this case, this type. I have a line entering, a line going, and then I'm not specifying, you have a sum over all possible diagrams inside here, as complicated as you want. Whatever diagrams you write this way, you also will have the same contribution with two blocks connected by one line here, and so on. You'll have a chain of many, many, many blocks. So each of these blocks basically group all the diagrams, Feynman diagrams, which are so-called one-particle irreducible. So all diagrams which are not of this kind. This kind means that these type of diagrams are so that if you cut them in the middle, you disconnect them. So all the diagrams that can be disconnected in this way, I put them in this chain here explicitly. All the diagrams which are not one particle irreducible, like these ones, I put it in a single block, because this they cannot be disconnected by just one cut. Okay? So this contribution here, then, will be of the form, I have a 1 over p squared minus m0 squared here. I have a I over p squared minus m0 squared here. And then here we'll have a blob, which will be in general a very complicated function of momentum. Let me call it pi of p squared. Okay? So this pi of p squared includes all possible diagrams which are the form of the blob. Of course, I have also contribution from here, so I have I over p squared minus m0 squared, pi, 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 so on. The sum of all these diagrams reconstruct a geometric series. Pi plus pi over p squared minus m0 squared plus this squared plus blah, 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 blah. So I can resum all these class of diagrams, and I get I over p squared minus m0 squared minus I over p squared minus m0 squared pi of p squared. Also equal to I over p squared minus m0 squared. Let me define this with an I, just so that I don't have this guy here. So basically, these were the self-interaction diagram we discussed a little sometimes ago. And after you resum them, what they do is just they shift the usual propagator by a quantity which is proportional to the interaction length. So now the propagator is more complicated in general when you consider also interactions, because you see, there is a non-trivial function of p squared in general, or in the room. So you can terror expand the pi of p squared around a generic point, in particular m squared, So m0 square is the mass that appears in the Lagrangian, the parameter of the Lagrangian. Then we span it around some other point, which I call m square. In this way. So I can always write it as pi computer p square plus this is that goes to zero when p square is equal to m square times some function pi t of the length of p square, which is moves when p square goes to m square. If I replace this is, if I replace this expression here, this becomes I over p square minus m0 square plus pi of m square plus p square minus m square pi theta of p square. Now I can choose m squared so that pi of m squared is equal to m0 squared minus m squared. Pi is just a function, right? I can choose m squared as a solution of this implicit equation. This is my definition of small m squared. If I do that, you see that if you replace it here, this term here becomes minus m squared. And now the propagator has a pole at p squared equal to m squared, because if p squared is equal to m squared, we get 1 over 0. And this is the physical mass of the theory, is the pole of the propagator. So you see that if your interaction produce terms that when resummed give you pi of p squared such that the constant term shifts in the propagator, it shifts the position of the pole, give a correction to the mass of the particle. So now this is also equal to I over p squared minus m squared times 1 plus pi tilde of p squared. This extra factor here, it's a smooth function of p squared when p squared is equal to m squared. So basically, here you get the pole. And this you can also write as, sometimes it's also written as p squared minus m squared with a z factor here. You see that when p squared is equal to m squared, you get the pole. The residue to the pole is just the value of this factor here. All this discussion is correct as long as this factor here is real. However, unstable particles have an imaginary part. It means that there must be some imaginary part here. And what happens is that this blob here has an untriggered imaginary part. So if this is the case, I can repeat the same discussion as I did, but here this pi now has both a real and imaginary part. So I can pull out the imaginary part here. So let me redo this exercise from here. I have this expression. Now I write it as pi real plus I pi imaginary. For pi real, I do the same trick. So pi real at, I write it as pi real at n square plus p square minus n square pi tilde real at p square. These two terms, I require them to be minus n square. And at the end, I can write this as zi, like before, p squared minus n squared. But now, I also have an extra term from I, plus I pi e p squared times z. In this case, z is defined as 1 over the same factor, but we'll just pi tilde real of p squared. So this is the final form for the two-point function with interactions. So in general, interactions can shift the pole of the propagator, but also by an imaginary part, if there is an imaginary part inside this bubble. But this bubble, what it is related to the one-to-one amplitude. It's all the diagrams that maps one particle to one particle. In fact, it can be shown that after you take into consideration the dressing of all these bubbles to the final particles, that this product here is nothing else than the imaginary part of the one-to-one particle, the one-to-one amplitude. You can approximately see it from here. Which we identified basically with this omega gamma factor here. So let's see what does it mean. So imagine you do the process like we did before. You scatter a plus and minus. And you produce an internal particle, not the photon. Let's say you produce a massive particle, like the Z boson, which is unstable. Then at three level, you get this diagram here. This amplitude will be proportional to the propagator of the Z boson, I over P squared minus the mass of the Z boson squared. But then you start considering a quantum correction to this. A quantum correction will also have blobs here. And you can resum the blobs like we did there. And the effective effect of these blobs is just to shift this propagator by this amount. So the general form will be some renormalized mass of the Z boson, but then it will also be here will be the Lorentz invariant x of the mass of the Z boson. In particular, when you compute the modulus square of the amplitude to compute the cross section, you'll get the modulus square of this contribution, which will give you a contribution which goes like basically this square, 1 over this square plus this square, which will be like in the center of mass frame, will be like something that goes like e total square minus the mass of the z square plus gamma square and z square, which is indeed a resonant-like structure. It will be maximized when the E total is equal to mz, but it will not explode. It will be just 1 over this quantity. And this gamma is proportional to the width of this resonance. The small gamma, the more gamma is small, the more this will be small and high. And the more long is the lifetime of the associated particle.
If the particle doesn't decay, when that part is zero, the only part that we have.
Like the photon. Uh-huh. Then this will never generate. Then it will be like this. But then, if it's not, then you will never be able to go to momenta p squared, which are exactly equal its mass. Because if this is the case, then it means that you will be able to conserve energy momentum between the initial state and this particle. So if this process happens, then also the reverse happens, and this particle is unstable.
Is it always possible for every particle?
Yes. If this amplitude is non-zero, the reverse is non-zero.
So what's the lifetime of electrons, for example?
Electron cannot decay.
So in that case, for electron?
Yes, but there will be no process and particle that produce an electron on shell. So if, for example, consider Compton scattering, you have an electron here, you'll see this process, you'll never be able to conserve energy momentum with this. So the propagator that appears here, p squared minus mass of the electron, will never go to infinity, will never be on shell. If this can go on shell, then the particle is automatically unstable. Indeed, you can see that if this can go on shell, then you can draw this diagram here. And you can show that this bubble here, if they can go on shell, as an imaginary part. So the two things are just one-to-one correspondence. The presence of the imaginary part for a bubble and the possibility for the one particle internal state to go on shell. Otherwise, you will get an infinite result for the cross-section. If you were able to go on shell and the particle is stable. So this is basically the relation between the width of a particle and its lifetime and the width of the resonance and basically the decay rate of the lifetime.
So what's measured from plot is actually something Lorentz invariant, lifetime times m squared or anything like
yes,
that.
Yes, it depends, yes.
So it's always invariant and we can read from the plot.
Yeah, the amplitude, yeah, if you put these internal lines inside some diagrams, you write the Lorentz invariant amplitude, then you get the Lorentz invariant combination of that. If you want, this is gamma zero. Because the combination between these two, omega gamma is also equal to 2m gamma zero, this is Lorentz invariant, because this was Lorentz invariant.
And this is only valid for decaying particles.
What is only valid?
Imaginary part of M exists only for
no.
Decaying particles.
No. This is true, the optical theory is true for any final state. Uh-huh. So it's always true that the. Indeed, you can do 2 to 2. And this part here, if you now look at our cross section for 2 to n particles, this guy was just sigma total times the factor which was delta v omega 1 omega 2, if I remember. And here you can relate the total cross section to the imaginary part of the amplitude, not the amplitude square. Yeah. And the reason is the following. Indeed, our E plus E minus, we compute E plus E minus by just taking the electron to muons, right? Quadruple square and computed this. We could have computed by using instead the optical theorem this without without doing modulus square of amplitudes. How? You see, you start with the plus and minus, and you want the final state to be exactly the same as the initial state. And in this amplitude, there will be a contribution which is like this, with a loop of minimum. This amplitude has an imaginary part. The imaginary part is basically corresponds to cutting this in two, and basically it's proportional to the modulus square of the amplitude e to mu and mu to e, which is n modulus square here. So you could have done the computation, just this diagram, and taken the imaginary part. Notice that the cross-section is the total one, which is sum over spin. The sum over spin is encoded in this loop. You remember, when you have a loop of fermions, you have a trace of P slash of the propagator. The trace of P slash of the propagator was exactly the trace of a spin we did in our computation. And you get exactly the same result. Of course, the theory is unitary, so the optical theorem just uses unitarity of the S matrix. And this is, of course, the two.
Isn't this more? Isn't this way to calculate the same thing that we calculated? This way is a little bit more longer than that, because we need to calculate this and take the imaginary part.
No, it's not that long. Because first of all,
We have the loop and we can directly write the trace. You mean that this?
Yeah, the loop already gives you the trace. You don't have to sum over spin and u bar, v bar, blah, blah, blah. You arrive directly. You see the propagator, the p slash plus m, p slash minus m. You then take the trace. And it's true that you have an integral over d4p here. And you have to take the imaginary part. But this integral in d4p, actually, it's the integral over phase space, which already did last time, the integral in d3p over, indeed, if you want, when you take the imaginary part of the propagator, what it does, it picks the particle on shell. So basically, it takes only the out of the contribution of the loop, where you sum over all momenta, the imaginary part picks up only the momenta which are where the internal particle are on shell. But this is because basically when you can write this guy here as some principal value plus I pi in the delta of p squared equals 2. So the imaginary part is associated to the delta which puts the particle on shell. And of course, I guess you already saw that since the propagator has this form, anytime you compute, like you use the Green function with interactions to see how the field evolves, you will get from this imaginary part an exponential decay of the amplitude of the field. You remember when you compute the field, for example, in classical field theory, with interaction, the field in the future could be written in perturbation theory as a convolution of the Green functions, right, acting to sources, right? Now your Green function, after you put the interaction contribution, will be corrected with an imaginary part here. This imaginary part, if you put them in the Green function, and you compute the Fourier transform of the Green function, you will produce, instead of e to the I omega t, now you get I omega plus I gamma t, and this will produce e to the minus gamma t factors inside the Green functions, which suppresses basically the response of a source to the field, which is the fact that the field generated by the source is actually decaying into new states.
Okay, I went a little bit faster.